serious incident on the road requires forensic examination. And inside the cordons, dedicated officers take on this challenge.
Move!
He's got something to answer, why hasn't he stopped in time?
This is the collision investigation team from Gwent Police.
Someone has got to do something wrong for it to happen on this road.
So what was he doing?
I can't see any logical explanation.
Tracking down the evidence.
See it?
It's there.
To get to the truth.
There's physical evidence. There's physical evidence.
The only way you can generate these marks is when you're applying heavy braking. Where the impact has occurred, it will drop all the mud. That's where his head sits. We refer to it as a bullseye.
That's one hell of a swerve.
All in a day's work for the crash detectives.
Hi, there's been a car accident on the M4.
We just had a call in relation to a possible fatal on the M4. Basic information is that it's a three-vehicle RTC. We're fighting through traffic and the crash is on the other carriageway. There's nothing on this site.
Collision investigator PC Tony Parker is battling rush hour traffic, but there's an added pressure.
This is going to have a knock-on effect as well, because we've got the Ed Sheeran concert in Cardiff tonight. This is where we are. They've buried it off as well now. Chaos. I've got to turn around and come back to all the tailback. WR413.
Go ahead.
Myself and 15 are off. 1725. Cheers, mate.
Both Tony and his colleague PC Richie Wyatt have been sent to investigate this serious crash.
Oof, it is a smash.
With traffic halted for emergency medical teams to land, doctors are now trying to save the life of a 56-year-old man.
I assume he's the occupant of this one.
He is, yeah. He's the driver of this one.
The car he was driving has been struck from behind by this Honda CR-V and then shunted forwards into the back of an Audi.
So he's walking wounded there. This is the guy that's being worked on, and obviously this guy here as well.
From collision investigation point of view, he's had his seatbelt on. Still with us or no?
Unfortunately not.
No, right, okay.
Despite paramedics arriving so quickly, the man driving this black Perodua Mivi has now died.
Yeah.
All right, well, we'll try and get this all clear so you can get at least the westbound open. We'll try and get away as soon as you can.
All right, thanks. You just come with me. We'll find out who's... We'll take your details, obviously, because you witnessed a collision.
Richie's now asking witnesses about the road conditions at the time of the crash, which has happened where a dual carriageway merges with a motorway.
The traffic that was ahead of you, would you say that's creeping or slow moving?
Yeah, pretty much
estimated speed?
Before we went on the bend.
Right.
Yeah, this was already really slow. I had this on coming around there because it was queuing, but I know it does on the A48.
Yeah,
you know?
Okay.
So I was slowing right up, but it was just starting to trickle, but I was aware of it being quite stationary still.
Did you see the collision itself?
Not in any detail, I just saw kind of debris and dust. And
I kind of heard the bang, and as I looked across, you literally saw the red car was in the air to the rear of the black. You know, I very definitely know that just a cloud of debris.
Okay.
But other witnesses also saw the orange Honda CR-V in the moments before the impact. They've described how it was being driven to senior investigating officer Sergeant Leighton Heelan.
The guy in the CR-V just comes along lane two and doesn't appear to slow at all. And just hits the car at speed.
The 60-year-old man who was driving the orange Honda CR-V is now on his way to hospital.
His injuries are relatively minor.
Yeah.
So I'm going to pause you that he's arrested, and we'll speak to him.
Potentially you could, yeah.
Yeah.
I think so.
Yeah.
He's got something to answer why hasn't he stopped in time, hasn't he? Yeah.
They must now bear in mind that serious offences may have been committed here.
The reason for it, we don't know yet, but this guy just hasn't stopped for the slowing traffic. So what was he doing?
They need to start finding that out. And as vehicles are now moved, they get their first clear view of the evidence on the road surface. But this crash is still having a knock-on effect for traffic passing on the other carriageway.
We'll have a bump there now because people are slowing down. Come on, hurry up! Get going! Move! People snarled up in this now that they've paid good money to go and watch a concert that they can't get to because we've got people trying to have a look at it.
So the crash scene is now being shielded from view by screens.
We have it so many times where there's rubberneckers having a look. Get on with it! The only one wanting to slow down. That's a hell of a shunt, mate, looking at the distance as well.
Yeah.
Long tyre marks are now visible, revealing where the Perodua and orange Honda CRV made contact.
And his locked tyres, that's as a result of him going into the back of the Perodua and being forced down, isn't it? The Perodua stopping his wheels rolling.
It was very limited braking, if anything, from the CRV.
Yeah.
Just before the tyre marks begin, they found this distinctive scrape mark.
Number one point of impact.
With the very first point of impact established, they still need to work out which component of which car has caused it.
Just have a quick look.
The right sort of stuff that's on the deck.
Exhaust.
Off the Perodua, where it's been forced downwards.
Yeah.
And the damage is extensive.
This is the rear near side wheel. That's the independent suspension. That's the rear offside tyre, wheel and assembly. It should be located over there, the corner of the vehicle, but it's been detached, pulled, and snarled under the vehicle, under the CRV. You get the metal components dragging across the road surface. The tyre's deflated, the alloy is shattered, and this is causing all the gouging. So you can see when you've got fresh gouging, you actually get the debris and the powder coming afterwards. So you know that's a fresh mark.
To cause damage like this requires huge force. And witnesses have already suggested that the orange Honda was being driven at speed.
This is how the vehicle's been left by the driver. Nobody's touched the vehicle at all. And looking at it, he's in sixth gear. It's a cruising gear. Most of the traffic ahead of this vehicle was stationary or was creeping speed. And therefore, you know, why is this vehicle in sixth gear?
Oh, I see it. Yeah, I got it.
Officers are now seizing any phones from inside the vehicles. And they'll all be sent for analysis.
This is in the passenger's front footwell.
But they found something else of particular interest inside the victim's car.
Some dash cam. So we'll seize this and see what it can tell us. Obviously, it's only probably showing what the driver was seeing at the time before he got hit from the rear.
Five and a half hours after they arrived, work at the scene is nearing completion. But the investigation has only just begun.
I have the physical marks at the scene on the road surface, the tyre marks, the point of impact that was created by the exhaust of the black Perodua movie. So At the time, yeah, I knew how the vehicles ended up, but how did they come together at the beginning of the collision?
Away from the pressures of the motorway scene, Richie's taking a closer look at the cars involved.
Marks at the scene are indicating to me that these vehicles have come together in a straight line, a linear motion, so it directly impacted one behind the other.
We'll bring it out.
Come this way a bit. Just for a touch.
With some help from colleague Dean Burnett, they're about to reconstruct the moment the vehicles first made contact.
You got this, the C pillar there, the rear pillar of the Perodua. You can see that the actual form of that will fit into the shape, the crease into the bonnet. Okay. We knew at this point that the Honda CRV had initially impacted into the rear of the black Perodua Mivi. And as a result of that, the two vehicles have stayed connected, moved forward, and then in tandem have impacted into the rear of the Audi A6.
And there's some telling evidence to prove this contact.
As a result of the collision at the back of the Audi, the Audi badge on the boot has impacted and made an imprint into the metal and the paintwork of the bonnet of the Perodua. We've got the four rings. I think it's safe to say that at some time, those three vehicles are all connected.
Probably connected at one point, before they would move separated.
Before they separated
again,
then they all decelerate at different rates. If you drop that down to, well, there's the marks, the rings. Yeah, that's it, yeah.
When you see the three cars like this, it really is a dramatic representation of the horrendous impact.
This reconstruction reveals the millisecond when they were all in contact.
You know, it's virtually reduced the length of the car by half. In that split second, you can't remember the energy and that amount of damage and...
Oh, yeah.
It's frightening, really.
It is frightening. We see crashes and we see the different extents of damage, but to see something of that magnitude, I'm starting to think, well, what has this driver done to avoid or try to avoid this collision? Has he done anything to try and avoid this collision?
It's just over 24 hours since the crash. The Honda driver has spent the night in hospital and must now face questions.
The only thing that I can remember is that I'm driving along and next thing I hit into the back of this car. And I was in shock then afterwards because it shouldn't have happened.
When you say it shouldn't have happened, what do you mean by that?
I drive every day.
Yeah.
Right? I'm on the motorways every single day.
Mm.
So my judgment is to watch out for traffic. I didn't see this at all.
So describe the first time you saw that black vehicle you collided with.
When I collided it.
That was the first time you saw when you collided with it.
Did you brake prior to that impacting?
I think I did. But it's just before we hit. I think I did.
With the driver offering few details, the pressure on the team is building. Back at headquarters, the investigation is continuing.
We've got slow-moving or stationary traffic at the 29 split.
And information from witnesses appears to be conflicting with the driver's version of events.
None of the witnesses have ever said he was driving particularly fast. What the common theme is, they're saying that he's just not braked.
He's just not braked.
Yeah.
He's just not anticipated.
He's not acknowledged and reacted to the hazard in front of him.
The collision unit sergeant, Bob Witherall, has asked if the network of traffic cameras covering the motorway can be of any help.
Yeah.
But so far, it's not looking good.
I've checked with Traffic Wales this morning. It's between two cameras. The one camera's pointing in the one way and the other camera's pointing the other way, so it's right in the blind spot of this, so it hasn't captured anything.
There's obviously that dash cam's been recovered from the deceased car as well.
There's no SD card in it.
There wasn't an SD card?
There's not an SD card in it.
Right, OK.
No SD card means it probably wasn't recording at the time. So any hopes for evidence from the dash cam belonging to the driver who died are fading fast.
We're quite conscious that we haven't got any CCTV footage of the collision itself. The dash cam now it hasn't recorded anything. The driver's given us a very limited explanation of what has occurred.
Describe to me the traffic conditions at that time.
Free flowing. Everyone was just cruising at 60, 70 miles an hour, mm-hmm. which I saw was enable for me to set the cruise control, safety and drive.
When did you set the cruise control in?
I was in the middle lane.
Right.
And once I saw that everything was kosher, I then touched the arm of cruise control.
Okay.
And then I just took my foot off the accelerator.
Okay. And what speed did you have it set at?
70.
And what gear are you in at that point?
Sixth gear,
okay.
He had said that he was in cruise control, travelling at 70 miles per hour. As a result of this, he's continued at that speed into the rear of the black Perodua Mivi.
After the point of impact, the orange Honda CRV pushed the black Perodua Mivi forwards by 46 metres.
The amount of force is absolutely massive. The questions I need to ask is, well, why hasn't he seen what's ahead of him? Why has he had that level of inattention that he hasn't seen the danger ahead?
Hello, Daniel. It's Michelle Greatrex. I'm a police officer from the collision unit at Gwent Police.
Although traffic cameras covering the motorway didn't record the moment of the crash, officers now want to find out if they've captured any of the Honda driver's journey.
Whatever you've got for that vehicle along the M4 corridor up to the location of the collision, I think what we're looking at is like manner of driving.
With this last-ditch hunt for footage now in motion, Richie's under pressure to find any further evidence. And the dash cam with a missing SD card found in the victim's car has been weighing on his mind.
If it was mounted on the windscreen and the level of force of the collision, would that force have dislodged the SD card out of the dash cam? And potentially, if it did, then maybe it may be a micro SD card somewhere in that vehicle. I went back to the garage where the vehicle was being stored. Doing the search, I wasn't that hopeful, really. It's a micro SD card, so it's going to be very, very small. As I'm searching down in the mat and lifting layers of papers.
That's it.
I was thinking it'd be too good to be true if this was the memory card from the device. Was this inside the camera at the time of the collision? I now add some real valuable evidence in terms of what happened moments before the collision had taken place.
See, everybody's slowing down, the Mivi's slowing down. This is the silver Audi A6. See the brake lights on the Audi. Everybody's reacted to the traffic conditions ahead. They've all slowed down.
The recording stops just before the crash itself, because the SD card is ejected in the impact.
Gotta ask the question, if the Mivi driver's seen it, why has another Honda driver seen it?
But it's suddenly clear that it's captured far more than just the journey leading up to the crash.
There were several files on the card, and looking at those files, it has recorded a significant amount before the collision.
This is more dashcam footage from the same black Perodua Mivi, as the driver joins the motorway at junction 32 in Cardiff. He then continues his journey along the eastbound carriageway.
This is the pertinent part. This is approximately 2.6 miles to the point of the collision. What we can see is the orange Honda CRV. Straight away. He's weaving within the lane. He's just coming across to the near side, back to the off side, clipping the lane markings.
back over to the near side. He's now straddling the lane markings between lanes 1 and 2, holding that position. No need to. He could have clearly come across, which ultimately he does, but no sooner that he does come across into lane 1, he's clipping a bit of the rumble strip. He's back out. And he's not completing a manoeuvre to take his vehicle from lane 1 to lane 2. He straddled the lane markings and he's back over. So there's this lack of concentration. And, yeah, he's veering left to right, left to right. And you know at this point the driver is quite clearly filming his own killer.
The man behind the wheel of the Honda drives for a living.
Something's going on in that vehicle. His concentration isn't there. And the question is, why isn't it there?
The driver needs to explain.
Well, here's your notes and dash camera footage that we've been able to get, okay? That vehicle in front, right in this middle lane, what's it doing? Tell me it's man or a driver.
He's going straight in the middle lane.
Middle lane, yeah? So he's across another lane one, yeah? Straddling the lanes?
Yes.
Recognise that vehicle?
Is that the Honda I was driving?
That is the Honda you were driving. That dash camera is functioning when it died in the collision. Can you tell me why that vehicle that you were driving would have been all over the road like that?
I can't. I didn't think I was doing that.
So just why was he driving in this erratic way? Investigations have revealed that for the last 20 years, the driver has had diabetes. But at the time of the crash, his blood sugar levels were found to be within normal range.
Thank you very much. Cheers. Thanks to that.
Devices found in his car were also seized immediately after the crash, and the analysis results are back.
There was no information to say that the gentleman was using his mobile phone or using the tablet whilst driving. We still don't know why the gentleman hasn't stopped and he's impacted with the rear of a vehicle.
With lines of inquiry diminishing, focus now returns to the motorway CCTV. It might not have caught the crash itself, but it could still hold vital clues.
When we started looking at the different cameras along that section of road, we could actually identify the orange Honda CRV on the captured footage.
So you should see the Honda come in at the bottom there.
And then we start piecing together the journey that vehicle has taken.
The Honda driver collects and delivers vehicles all over the UK. On the day of the crash, he'd left his home in Milton Keynes at 5 o'clock in the morning. When he's seen in the footage here, it's almost 12 hours later. He's done his last pickup of the day and still has a 3-hour drive home. This is also where the black Perodua Mivi joins the motorway and begins to gain on the Honda.
There's the Mivi, standalone, lane 2. And then immediately behind, you've got the orange CRV.
The Perodua Mivi has now overtaken the Honda CRV.
So there they are. We've got the Mivi now holding lane 2. Nothing in front, nothing behind. Still nothing behind. And then lane 2 directly behind the Mivi, the Honda CRV.
This is the last time they're seen on the footage before the crash. And it's this final shot that Richie wants to analyse.
So we're going to use this lamppost as a fixed position on the actual CCTV. So we'll just get the front near side of the Mivi in line with the lamppost. 19 seconds on the clock, and we'll run the Mivi through then. And what we'll try to do now is when the Honda comes through, is travelling directly behind it, locate the Honda in exactly the same position we started timing the Mivi. So we'll bring the Honda and we'll pause it then. So there, and that's showing 25 seconds. So the Mivi went past that point in 19 seconds. The Honda is going past the exactly
the same point that maybe he went at 25 seconds, so it was a 6 second gap.
There was a clear unobstructed distance between the two vehicles, and they were 6 seconds apart. So yeah, that is a significant amount of distance and time.
But there's more that this footage can reveal about the last few moments leading up to the impact. As the Honda driver passes the lamppost, still in cruise control, he has just 400 meters left to travel before colliding into the back of the black Perodua Mivi.
So now work out that whilst traveling at 70 miles an hour, would have taken 12 seconds to cover that distance of 400 meters. So the Honda would have had 12 seconds in order to do something about the changing road circumstances ahead of him. There's been no reaction from him.
You have 12 seconds of view of everything that's happening in front of you. What were you doing?
Well, I wasn't sleeping. I was wide awake. I know that, Robert. But I just didn't see it. All I do know, all I can say is I didn't black out. I didn't have a hypossession, whatever you call it.
He's denying he had a hypoglycemic attack. But there's something that the diabetic driver chose not to reveal to officers after the crash. They've now discovered that he carried on with his day on the road, despite having collapsed that morning. He insisted he'd felt fine after eating and continued to drive.
Did you give thought at that point to saying, do you know what, I'm not going to drive today, I'm not fit?
If anything else had happened to me, yes, I would have, but nothing else happened. I was fine after that.
He's been on the road since 5 o'clock that morning. He's fainted, his blood sugars are low, he knows his medical condition, he's tired.
Were you driving with all the care and attention you should have been at that time?
I was fine. I was wide awake. Looking forward to going home.
For somebody to travel 12 seconds and not know what's happening ahead, yeah, it's significantly dangerous.
The driver denied causing death by dangerous driving, but he was found guilty.
The erratic driving, the vehicle veering and drifting in the lane is all consistent with somebody who is struggling with concentration, fatigue.
In court, the judge said that his decision to drive, after collapsing, put other road users at substantial risk, long before the collision itself. He told him he should have stopped driving and gone home.
This is a collision that could have been quite easily avoided, but he's continued to drive on that road.
He was jailed for 4.5 years.
All the way through, he just could not give a reasonable, plausible explanation of why he didn't see what was happening ahead of him. And somebody has paid the ultimate price and lost their life.
Somebody sini meski hati berkata tak mampu, tak ingin terlambat menyudahi keadaan ini, mungkin ini jalan kita dan haruskah kita. Sampai di sini, meski hati berkata tak mampu, tak ingin terlambat menyudahi keadaan ini, mungkin ini jalan kita. Terjadi.